Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 11th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take agenda items 4, 5 and 6 and 7 in private. Are members of the committee content to do that? Mm-hmm. Yes, we are. Thank you very much. Agenda item 2 is a session with the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life, Ian Bruce, who is joining us at the committee this morning. And this follows up an Audit Scotland report, which was published several weeks ago, a Section 22 report looking at the audit of the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland's latest performance. At that session, we had some discussion towards the end of the evidence about whether Ian Bruce, you were the accountable officer as well as the commissioner, and just for the record, I can confirm that you are. That's correct, isn't it?
It is.
Thank you very much indeed. We've obviously got quite a number of questions that we want to put to you this morning, Ian, but before we get to those, could I ask you to make a short opening statement to the committee?
Certainly. Thank you, convener and members of the committee, for the invitation and for the opportunity to talk to you about the work of our office. I will keep this statement brief, as I am sure that you will have a number of questions for me. I trust that you've reviewed our last two annual reports and the two Section 22 reports laid by the Auditor General for Scotland into the work of our office. And these will have given you a flavour of the challenges that our organisation has faced since I took up my role as Acting Commissioner almost 2 years ago now. I don't plan to rehearse all of those challenges here, although I'll be very happy to respond to any questions that you have for me in relation to those. I felt it may instead be more helpful at this point to bring the committee briefly up to speed on the office's current circumstances and our plans for the future. Audit Scotland's Section 22 report from January followed up on our office's progress in the usual way, and it reflected positively, I feel, on the work that we've done to rebuild our office and the services that we provide and to restore confidence in the ethical standards framework. However, it also made it clear that more work has to be done to embed the good practices that we have adopted since the last Section 22 report was laid by the Auditor General. In terms of the progress made, we've included all of the details on our website and in summary in our annual report, and we'll continue to keep the public and our stakeholders updated on our progress. In brief, we've now fully implemented 16 of our auditor's 26 recommendations. That number may not be familiar, but some of the recommendations were multi-part and we split them up just in order to track our progress appropriately. We've partially implemented the remainder that we are able to, and I'll happily provide more detail during the course of this session. We've concentrated on re-establishing our governance, our systems of assurance, our relationships with stakeholders and our staffing levels. On that front, we are in the midst of recruitment to fill roles that were approved by the SPCB in October, with three new staff members now in post and currently going through their induction, and four more being brought on board between now and May. We have some assurance that we are making progress. Our internal auditors last year reviewed our systems of governance and our investigations procedures and assessed the controls in place as substantial, and they assessed our risk management controls as strong. In terms of my plans for the immediate future, I intend to complete our office recruitment exercise, followed by induction, in order to clear our investigations backlog and in order to process complaints much more quickly in the future. I've also developed a range of new and some updated key performance indicators, which we will implement soon and subsequently publicly measure our progress against, and that will be on our website. For the longer term, I am due to produce a new strategic plan for the period from 2024 to 2028, which will set out my ambitions for the future. I trust this is of interest to the committee, and I'm now happy to answer any questions you may have.
Commissioner, thank you very much indeed. And I think our working list was 22 recommendations, and the breakdown, I think, of 10 that had been implemented at the time of the Audit Scotland report's publication, and 10 which were work in progress. So I'm sure during the course of the next hour we'll get into some of the detail of the recommendations and what progress you've made, and if you've reconfigured them, we'll maybe get to the bottom of that too. But I'm going to go first of all to Willie Coffey, who's got an extremely important question that certainly exercised us very much at the last session that we had with the Auditor General. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Ian. It's really about the issue about public confidence and restoring public confidence, and you mentioned it in your remarks there. We know that advice has been given to you that you cannot revisit complaints that were made in the past. And other members have raised this matter with you previously. Do you not think that there's an obligation in terms of natural justice and to restore public confidence that we do reinvestigate complaints that were clearly not handled appropriately? The Auditor General's report in paragraph 19 refers to this, that there's a potential feeling of injustice that complaints have not been invested in compliance with the legislation at the time. So, on balance, do you not feel that greater weight should be attached to that aspect of restoring public confidence rather than the advice that you may have received to not revisit those complaints?
To be honest with you, I've struggled with this myself because I have met personally with some of the individuals affected by this, but I think it's important for the committee to have a full understanding of the situation. So the auditor's recommendation was not that I reopen and reinvestigate complaints. The recommendation was that we have someone external to the office come in and independently review my predecessor's decisions. That was the recommendation. In order to establish whether or not it was possible for me to take forward that recommendation, because it would have required a significant amount of contingency funding from the SPCB, I'd asked the auditors, what advice is this based on? Have you sought legal advice in relation to this recommendation? They confirmed that they hadn't, and I felt obliged to seek that legal advice in order to have a proper understanding of what the position was. I'm not a lawyer myself, so the advice came as a bit of a surprise to me, but I do have a very deep understanding of it now. The legal term for it is functus officio, and I don't have much of a grounding in Latin either, but members may be familiar with a similar term in relation to criminal justice, and it's the concept of double jeopardy. And basically, functus officio is the equivalent of double jeopardy in relation to the work of public authorities. And it means that a public authority, having made a decision, that decision cannot be revisited. Now, I truly understand what you're saying about, how it feels in terms of natural justice for those whose complaints were investigated and no breach found, or in cases in which the Commissioner concluded that there wasn't a breach on the face of the code and therefore it wasn't worthy of investigation. And I do understand and empathise with the position of those complainers who feel that they didn't receive justice. On the other side, you have a range of councillors, board members, who feel that they were exonerated either at the end of an investigation or felt that, fine, the Commissioner's view was there wasn't on its face a breach of the code. And having been exonerated in their eyes, how would they feel if 2 years down the line another commissioner comes in, the same complaint is made to that commissioner, and that commissioner then goes back and overturns the decision of a previous one? The legal advice to me was unequivocal. There are only very narrow circumstances in which a complaint can be revisited or a public authority's decision. It goes further than that. The legal advice was I would be acting unlawfully if I sought to overturn the decisions of my immediate predecessor. And I trust you will understand that in the position of a parliamentary office holder, I could not, in good faith, choose to disregard legal advice that I had taken, because it would end up potentially with me in a position of having to try to defend a legal case, which, you know, would involve public money, resources, time, which I would have no reasonable prospect of winning, based on that legal principle. So believe me when I say, you know, I do struggle with this myself. It has been challenging for me, but fundamentally, I did not feel that I could act unlawfully in good faith. I'll go further. So it was legally privileged advice, but it was shared with the SPCB and the Standards Commission for Scotland because, yeah, I sought their input prior to making this decision. And I'd be more than happy to share that advice with the committee in full. I am very transparent about my work, but that's the position.
That was going to be my next question, whether that advice could be shared either in private or public, even with this committee. So it's very much appreciated if that's possible, Ian. But just to emphasise the point that what we're being told here is that that direction overrides the requirement, the duty to deliver justice to people who have raised complaints. And I'd like to separate the complaints that were dealt with and perhaps the complainant is unhappy with the outcome compared to complaints that were not properly investigated. How on earth could that direction supersede those? That's sure. What I find it difficult to understand.
Yes. So the it comes down to the founding legislation in relation to the acquittal of that particular statutory function, which is the 2000 Act, so the Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland Act, and it makes it clear, there's a section in that which says whether, when and how to conduct an investigation are statutorily matters for the Commissioner. Those were the decisions that Commissioner made at that time, and statutorily those were her decisions to make. And I am not in a position to overturn them because of the legal principle. So again, you know, I truly empathise with some individuals who feel like, you know, my complaint should have been investigated, but her decision was, no, on the basis of what's before me, it is not appropriate to investigate, and statutorily, those were her decisions to make.
Is it asked this question as well previously, convener, is it possible for people to submit a fresh complaint about those matters?
Yeah, I'm happy to talk to the narrow circumstances in which I can revisit a public authority's decisions, and they are very narrow, and again, you will find them in the legal advice, but so there has to have been a fundamental mistake of fact, or there has to have been fraud, or the public authority has not completed its inquiries. So if complainers are able to come to me, let's say with fresh evidence, so, you know, here is something new that your predecessor was not aware of at the time that decision is made, then there is scope for me to look at that potentially again. And anyone who comes to me and I feel that, you know, I have the leeway to pursue their case in a defensible way, I will do that. But if it's exactly the same complaint that comes and a decision's already been made on it, my hands are tied.
Okay. Thank you for that so far. I wondered if you could just update the committee on progress with, it was one of the recommendations made about the full investigations manual and so on that came out of this.
Yes.
This experience, could you update the committee in progress?
By all means. And it will not surprise the committee that, you know, I'm aware of prior sessions, and I think it had been mentioned that it was a bit of a coincidence that the manual came out for consultation not long before the session last year. I think it was with the SPCB. So it's not a coincidence. The full investigations manual is being... or it is a coincidence, the full investigations manual is being published tomorrow following public consultation in last November. I would like to be clear about this as well, and you know, this is not a criticism of the auditors, but we put that manual together in November 2021. That's how long we've had an investigations manual in place and how long we've been working to it. It hasn't, so it's been a work in progress. only to the extent that we've been updating it based on feedback that we've had from people while we've been operating it. But we've been operating it for a very long time. It's now on version 9. We chose to go beyond the auditor's recommendations because they'd said, you know, produce this workforce, investigations manual. We did. We chose to consult publicly on it. You know, we've spoken about my strong desire to restore public confidence in the work of the office, and that has been about being transparent, not just about how we plan to investigate things, but actually seeking people's views. This is how we plan to go about our business. What are your thoughts? So there was an extensive consultation period with the Standards Commission and with all the local authorities, the monitoring officers, in advance of our even publicising it for public consultation. Final version is going to be published tomorrow, but it will be a living document. It will continue to be a living document. So, it's very well embedded. I think I mentioned during my opening statement, so last year our internal auditors had a look at our investigations procedures and said, you know, you have substantial controls in place in relation to these.
Finally for me, Convener, then, just your views to put on the table, Ian, about the lessons that may have been learned from that process of the concluded investigations and so on. What sort of lessons have we learned? Have you learned there that will deliver that public confidence and restore that public confidence that you've mentioned a few times?
Yes. Checks and balances are really, really important in the ethical standards framework. The reality is, my predecessor, her relationship with the Standards Commission for Scotland broke down, and they brought in a set of directions. And I think those, frankly, in and of themselves, can give the public a great deal of confidence. And I am working very much in partnership with the Standards Commission. But basically, anything that comes to my office, again, other than in really narrow circumstances, I am statutorily obliged to investigate. And I can provide assurance to this committee and Standards Commission and anyone else with an interest that I do investigate anything that may have merit that comes before me is properly investigated. I report on the results of that investigation to the Standards Commission. The Standards Commission isn't bound by my decisions. So justice is absolutely baked into that system now.
Okay. Many thanks, Ian. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed. I mean, just going, one of the alarm bell figures that we've seen over the course of the last couple of years is that statistic about the number of cases, complaints that were progressed and those that were not. And I think the contrast is between 2 years. So we were told that in 2016-17, complaints against councillors and members of public boards, 43% of those complaints were not pursued, i.e. 57% were pursued. But by the time we get to 2020-21, 84% of those complaints were not pursued. And that was one of the things which I think sent out a clear signal to people that they had lost confidence in the system. And that something was going wrong. There was such a big contrast. I mean, could you, you might want to reflect on that, but could you also perhaps tell us what the current figure is of complaints against councillors and public board members? We'll take that as the test area, yes, to find out what the figures are now.
Yes, so we track this regularly, and I can assure the committee that we are back at previous levels. You know, we've gone back to the sort of 27, so not my immediate predecessor, but prior to that, we went back to 2017, 2018, and we are back at previous levels in terms of, well, in fact, just above previous levels in terms of acceptance for investigation. Absolutely. And I'm more than happy, and I might have started by saying this to the committee, any detail that you want from me at any point in time, not necessarily in a public session, just say the word and I will provide you with all the statistical information that you require, because we're across all of that.
If subsequent to today's session, if you could provide us in writing with the comparable figure,
yes,
for current date, that would be a useful measure for us to understand whether things are back to a level that most people would recognise.
By all means. I have a table in the office. I will happily send a copy when I get back to the office today, which will show you the last, I think, 5-6 years
Fine. No, that would be good. We're a public audit committee. On the one hand, we don't believe in coincidence. And on the other, we like to see statistical evidence to support arguments that are put before us. The other thing, just a very small thing, was I thought when you replied to Willie Coffey, you mentioned, you did mention the corporate body of the Parliament. You are, of course, an independent commissioner.
Yes.
Can I just check, the legal advice you sought on whether or not there could be a resurrection of these cases that were dismissed without investigation, did you pay for that legal advice? Was that your legal advice or was that the Parliament's legal advice?
That was my legal advice, yes.
Fine. Thank you. I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Vera. Ian, I'm going to talk about governance and probably refer you to page 4, exhibit 1 of the Audit Scotland report, which seeks to give a wee graph on that. The Section 22 report says that the auditor has commented about, and I quote, issues remain where SPCB and the Commissioner's Office need to work together to address some of the specific governance issues identified. Maybe you can give me a little bit of update on what's happening in that regard, what discussions you're having, what areas of governance issues have been of most concern and maybe have been resolved.
It's still a work in progress, I would say. As the convener has pointed out, I'm a parliamentary office holder, so I don't have a board of governance, and I think potentially that's an issue. So one of the things that I am looking again to sort of bake into our system, I do operate with a senior management team. And I've been in regular discussions with them. We've drafted new terms of reference that we want to run through our advisory audit board, which I'll come to shortly as well. But included in that is a requirement on them not only to support me in my role as office holder, but they aren't non-executives. They aren't executives. We're talking about grade 5 staff. But there's a requirement on them to constructively challenge me in my role as well. And I will sign off those terms of reference. So that's one thing that we are planning to do internally. I've re-engaged with the Advisory Audit Board, but their role is strictly advisory. So they can advise me on issues like risk management, etc. But they have no challenge function. So I think potentially we do need to do more in terms of the external validation of the governance that we have in the office. The statutory route for that is the Auditor General for Scotland. So, we have external audit of the work that we do, and that has resulted in two Section 22 reports coming to this committee. So that's one aspect of oversight of our governance as well. In terms of discussions with the SPCB, and I'm sorry if this appears to be muddling, but I have so many reporting lines, and that perhaps is one other issue for consideration. But they have provided me with terms of reference, terms and conditions of appointment, a framework document, and I also have a range of KPIs that I require to meet. So I can be removed from office by the SPCB if they feel that I am not adhering to the terms and conditions of my employment. I'm subject to an annual review as well. They are also looking at introducing potentially a new code of conduct for all office holders, which I and other office holders are due to meet the SPCB to discuss in due course as well. So nothing necessarily finalised yet. We've also been in discussions with the AAB, and we're going to provide a route for whistleblowing via the chair of the AAB for staff members, and potentially there could be a route from the AAB to the SPCB as well. Yes.
AAB?
Excuse me, Advisory Audit Board. So we have an Advisory Audit Board, and its members are drawn from the Advisory Audit Board of the SPCB. What there isn't currently in place is a reporting line from our Advisory Audit Board to the Advisory Audit Board of the SPCB, and perhaps that's something that could be considered as well.
I think, given what you're saying about your relationship with the SPCB, we've always been a wee bit vague as to how much authority they've actually got over you. You're obviously an independent function. Could you define the areas in which the SPCB exert governance over your office or support your office, because obviously they do funding and everything for you, and where could that be improved? Is the SPCB the major governing body that you refer to?
So again, there are a number of reporting lines. I'll refer to the Standards Commission now, because they were the ones who brought in directions for the office because of, you know, concerns about the way in which investigations were handled. So, you know, that side of the office's work is covered there. Governance is my responsibility as the accountable officer. The SPCB's oversight is to do with the budget and with the staffing levels and whether or not I'm adhering, again, to my terms and conditions. Other checks, I am not sure, to be honest with you, what might be put in place. As I've said, you know, from my perspective, it's Audit Scotland and then to this committee. And in terms of the Act, so the Commissions and Commissioners Act that established my office, it talks about scope for removal of a commissioner when things are not going well. So the SPCB has scope to remove if I'm not adhering to my terms and conditions. The other mechanism for removal is much less clear and vaguer, and it's if a commissioner, basically, you know, the Parliament loses confidence in the commissioner. I am not sure what the mechanism is for removal there and how it might be taken forward, and I think potentially there's scope there for the committee to look at that. It's difficult for me to say, because recommendations were made for my office that I clearly can't implement. You know, I've been in discussions with the SPCB, but fundamentally I think these are matters for Parliament, which is how do we deal with a situation in which a commissioner starts to disengage? I think I could highlight a number of red flags that, you know, the committee should be aware of for the future and the SPCB should be aware of for the future. So I am now fully engaged with our advisory audit board, as I've said, but disengagement from an advisory audit board should be a red flag. Disengagement from stakeholder bodies such as the Standards Commission, such as the SPCB, should be another red flag. I now have an internal audit function, which historically our office has never had, but, you know, if the internal audit function were to fall away, potentially that would be another red flag. We're introducing new reporting routes for staff or stakeholders who are concerned about potentially the way in which I am operating. So any, you know, reports that could be made, for example, to the Chief Executive of the Parliament, who's accountable officer overall, given that, you know, my budget falls within the Parliament's budget, that could be another. These are all things that the committee might, and the SPCB might wish to consider, and potentially Audit Scotland as well. I know the focus traditionally is on finance. I know from your work, you'll be familiar with the Section 22 reports that come before you. It's very rarely finance that Section 22 reports are about. It tends to be about failures in governance.
Given what you're saying here, there still seems to be a lot of vagueness as to where the support, the oversight, the governance really is. And are you having discussions with SPCB to seek clarification on that? Because, you know, everything I hear is they're really the body, the closest thing you've got to a governing body. Would you agree?
I'm not sure that I would. I wouldn't say a governing body. I would say that they are there to provide oversight of my governance as an independent office holder. Yes.
You'd be expecting SPCB to be the organisation that picks those up and does something about them?
I think that would be a matter for the Parliament, frankly.
It sounds like there's an awful lot of things that haven't yet been clarified. And, you know, without that clarification, it seems to me there could be circumstances in which we end up in problems again.
Potentially. I think I've explained the measures that I have put in place in order to provide assurance, and I am content with what I am doing as an organisation in order to provide assurance. But that's all that I can do for my part.
What's unclear to me is
yes.
where the support for you is in terms of governance and so on, in terms of that oversight which you're talking about. Clearly it failed previously. What I think this committee is trying to ascertain is what are the possibilities of it failing again down the line, not necessarily now, but 5, 10 years or whatever, and are there adequate, as you say, red flags that somebody would pick up and respond to?
So, for my own part, I think Audit Scotland is the one statutorily who has that, you know, direct oversight role at the granular level of the work which my office does, and they have a reporting.
Yes. Audit Scotland come in and do an audit.
Yes.
And obviously they produce a report on that.
Yes.
But they don't have a direct responsibility for the day-to-day running and oversight of...
No.
of your office.
But nor would I posit does the Parliament. I am an independent office holder, and I absolutely understand why you're asking these questions. You know, I do, because I lived through a period in which the governance of the organisation was heading in the wrong direction. Mm. And, you know, I would not want that to be repeated either in my office or in any other, but it is one of the challenges involved in having an independent office holder who is truly independent of the Scottish Parliament. So I understand what you're saying. You know, is there sufficient in there at the moment in terms of direct oversight of the work of the organisation? What else could be put in place? I mean, I do have regular meetings with the SPCB now. And, you know, I share any information with them that they wish to see, and that is around providing assurance to them. Equally, clearly, you know, you have a role as a committee in terms of providing oversight, particularly when audit concerns are raised. I have two other subject committees that I, you know, provide information to on a very regular basis. So for my part, I think I am providing all that I can. What I do not feel I can do in good faith is say to this committee, these are the things that the SPCB should be doing in order to provide oversight or assurance that you feel needs to be in place. I do think ultimately these are matters for the Parliament. Notwithstanding that those recommendations were included in a Section 22 report for me, I feel I am doing all that I can, and I have been in discussions with the SPCB. I know they've given evidence to this committee, and I understand that, you know, that work is ongoing more widely than just in terms of my office, but I'm not sure what else I can offer
as far as this committee is concerned. We come in at the end of a problem,
sure.
If you like. What we're looking for is these red flags that you talked about. Who is alert to them? Who can do something about it and intervene? And to me, at the moment, from what I hear, that is not clear. And I think there's more work needs to be done on that, and I'm sure this committee will follow that through.
Yes.
Can I just ask about, I mean, we're talking about governance and so forth. You obviously have working relationships with the Standards Commission, the SPCB, and you mentioned two committees of the Scottish Parliament that you're primarily involved with. Who are these two committees?
So in respect of public appointments, MSP complaints, complaints about lobbying, that's the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee of the Scottish Parliament. And in respect of councillor complaints, it's the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee.
What do you consider your current relationship with the two subject committees and the Standards Commission, whom I'll come to you in a little bit more depth in a second? How do you think your working relationships are with these? Is that working?
Yes, very positive. Very positive. I've got a very long-standing relationship with the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, because prior to taking up the role as Acting Commissioner, I'd been working in the field of public appointments, which continues to be a passion for me, given its importance and you will understand that, given that, you know, it's the work of boards that quite frequently you look at. But since 2005, and I've got, you know, a very good long-standing relationship with that committee, and they have a proper understanding of me as an individual and the way in which I work and my commitment to transparency. I've organised training for the entire investigatory team with the committee, so they're all coming into the Parliament in April. You know, that will give you an indication of how strong that relationship is. And whenever they have turnover in clerks or potentially members, I'm happy to go in and provide training, for example. My relationship with the local government committee is newer, but, you know, I had a very productive, I think, evidence session with them relatively recently. A good relationship with the clerks, and that's something that I plan to build on. In terms of the Standards Commission, one of the first things I had to do when I became acting commissioner was meet with the convener and executive director and just say, you know, I truly understand, you know, some of the challenges that you have faced working with my immediate predecessor, and, you know, I am here to reset that relationship. You know, let me know from your perspective what went wrong, and I will work very hard to address it, and we continue to work, I would say, in partnership. We don't always agree, but, you know, you would expect that. We're both independent, and I think the public would expect that as well, but that doesn't mean that we don't work very closely together. We have fortnightly meetings with the staff, you know, all the staff in our office and their office, just to provide updates and discuss areas of mutual interest. I've got biannual meetings with all the members. Most recently, last week, I and colleagues attended a workshop for the standards officers of public bodies in Scotland. It was run by the Standards Commission. It was based in Causeless HQ, and I was there presenting on the same stage as, you know, the members of the commission. So that's a completely different relationship.
Just one last quick question. You've mentioned about the Standards Commission and the statutory directions,
yes,
which are still in place.
Yes.
What's the latest position on compliance with these statutory directions?
Yes, we've been complying fully since I was appointed, and, you know, the Standards Commission has written to the Parliament in terms.
Have you had any discussions with them as to how long these directions might be in place?
Yes, we have. You know, they have consulted us on those. So, you know, it does cause some additional work for the office, but notwithstanding that, and as I said in front of the local government committee, it is providing that level of public assurance. And, you know, given the uncertainty that there has been, I think clearly is my view that it's worth maintaining so that the public can see that, yes, you know, I make these decisions, but they're, you know, they go somewhere else as well. And
so it's an open-ended arrangement at the moment?
So the first two sets of directions, and I don't know how much detail the committee would like, but I'm happy to go into quite a lot if that would be your preference. But the first two sets of directions were recently renewed for 2 years. The first one relates to keeping all parties basically up to date with how an investigation is going. So, you know, at 3 monthly intervals, we let every party to a complaint know how the investigation is going. So that was the first one. It was renewed for 2 years last year. The second one is a reporting direction. So it requires us to report on the outcome of every investigation to the Standards Commission. So, you know, there's no scope for me to not report once an investigation is concluded. It was renewed for 2 years as well. The third set of directions came in just prior to my predecessor going on a period of leave. And for short, that's the eligibility direction, but it's the one that, you know, requires me to investigate pretty much everything other than in very narrow circumstances. So we did discuss that one with the Standards Commission, and they concluded, and it was a constructive dialogue, they concluded that it would be appropriate to renew it for 6 months, but that was on the basis that we've, in our investigations manual, the eligibility criteria are written into the manual so that, you know, the public can see these are our procedures And I think they are probably going to be content that because that's on the face of our investigations procedures, and those are subject to internal audit, and they know they can ask for detail on any of it at any given time, which we provide anyway, as I say, on a fortnightly basis, I think they're going to be content that that one won't need to be renewed because it's now just, you know, it's work as usual for our office.
Thank you.
Right, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to move things on now because one of the issues that we've come back to several times this morning, but in previous sessions that we've had with the Auditor General, has been on staffing capacity and performance. And I'm going to invite Ros McCall to ask some questions around that issue. Ros.
Thank you, Convener. And yes, hello, Mr. Bruce. Thank you very much indeed for attending. And it's the first time I've met you, so nice to see you. The report was excellent, and there was some issues coming across regarding capacity for staffing and performance. And you're going to be very specific. Paragraph 25 on page 8, there is a very pertinent line. Whilst additional recruitment will help, it will take time for this to be completed and for new staff to be trained to a standard, the standard required. Excuse me. So as much as I can accept that, I need to know a little bit more about what training will be required. How long do you anticipate that that will take to get the staff up to speed, and more really as to how that will help your forward planning?
Yes. So in terms of workforce planning, that was completed last May. I brought it forward because I'd established by that point in time that we weren't getting through the backlog sufficiently quickly. It was an extensive workforce planning exercise. It resulted in a business bid to the SPCB 31st of May. I met with the SPCB in October. I think that was the earliest opportunity. And the bid was accepted shortly thereafter. I spent November planning with my senior management team and started recruitment in November. So that was for all of the sort of investigatory roles, the new investigatory roles that we were looking to fill, and three of the corporate services roles that we were looking to fill. We are onboarding people at the moment. So I've mentioned, you know, there are three new staff in place. They are all going through their induction. Induction takes roughly a month, but, you know, as they're being inducted, they're not only being introduced to their roles, but also their own individual action plans for the year ahead. Performance framework was also mentioned in the Section 22 report, so that's, you know, that's well established now. We have a strategic plan, a biennial business plan that sits below that, action plans for every section in the office, and then below that, action plans for individual staff members. So all of that is mapped out, including for the new people. So I hope that addresses your question in terms of planning. So roughly a month for induction. Training will take a bit longer, and it's simply because of the nature of the work. So although the people I have hired, and I'm really delighted with the quality of people who've come forward and that I've been able to appoint, all with really, really good investigatory backgrounds, as with myself, they will now have to get up to speed on two separate pieces of legislation and three separate codes of conduct, and all of the precedent that sits behind that in terms of Standards Commission for Scotland's prior decisions. It's not a judicial process, but it's quasi-judicial, and some of these things are quite specialist. So to use a simple example, decisions on planning applications, licensing and so forth, you know, where complaints about that sort of thing arise. I'm not going to call it arcane, but it's quite specialist. So even if you've got a really good grounding in investigations, it will take you a while to get up to speed on what can be quite a technical area. We do have a training timetable set out for all the staff who we onboarded previously, and also for all of the ones who are coming in. So they will go through training in all of these areas. That's just one area. Another one is investigating cases of bullying and harassment, including sexual harassment. So we employ not only our legal advisors in relation to investigating complaints of that nature, but we also engage with Rape Crisis Scotland so that people have an understanding of, you know, how their interactions for people involved in complaints of that nature should be handled. I would say certainly by this time next year, everything will be in place and you will be looking at, well, hopefully I will not be in front of the committee this time next year, but, you know, clearly that's not my decision to make. But I certainly anticipate and expect that we will be a really well-functioning office by this point next year. Our backlog will be cleared and we will be getting through complaints much more quickly than the office ever has.
Okay. Can I just follow up on that? Because you've mentioned three new members of staff. Yes. Excellent. Glad to hear that. We had anecdotally heard that there was an increase of staff up to 7.4
yes.
Full-time equivalents. So you're kind of running on half. Is there a move to increase that to the 7.4? Are you still recruiting? And secondly, really, from the information you've given me, are you seeing, is it the three new staff that will take approximately to this time next year that they'll be up and running and fully, or just give a little bit more information?
By all means. So recruitment so far has been for the corporate services team and for the investigations team. And it is it's the majority of those are the new posts. So they're, of the 7.4. In corporate services, we had no IT support within the office, so we have a new IT officer coming on board next month. Of the three who've come in already, one is a corporate services officer and one is an HR and facilities officer, and the other one is an investigations support officer. The four who are due to join us, one is a hearings and investigations officer, because we have more hearings than we've had previously, the other two are investigating officers. Public appointments will come later, and that's simply because I was the public appointments manager, and until such time as we knew who the identity of the new commissioner was going to be, because clearly there was no guarantee that it was going to be me, I would have returned to that substantive post. Now I'm not, so I'm now in discussions with who is now the public appointments manager and her public appointments officer about recruitment into public appointments roles.
Okay, thank you. That helps a lot. So staffing, as far as I can see, it moves towards the sort of the medium-term planning of moving forward, and there were some gaps also in the report regarding medium-term planning. So if I can ask you a wee bit about that, if that's okay. The medium term plan has almost reverted back on itself from the report. It looked like there was going to be some cuts and some savings in finances, and that has actually been superseded. So what progress has been made towards completing the medium term plans? And can you give us some information on the financial stability and sustainability over that?
Sure. So I think I'd like to separate two issues out. One is strategic and business planning. Okay. All of that is in place. And I think in fairness to us, so our strategic plan, which was one of the first things I put together and consulted on, did include financial information and projections. So it's not as though, those weren't in place to an extent. They were, because, the strategic plan was costed. The recommendation is that we have a medium-term financial plan. We don't have that in place yet, and I do understand that it is something that's considered quite important for us. We have been in dialogue with Audit Scotland, looking for examples potentially that we could follow. We've looked at a range of organisations' plans, but we found nothing really that's equivalent for a parliamentary office holder. And it's because our only funding stream is the SPCB. That's it. And our only expenditure really is on staff. We don't have assets. We rent an office. So medium-term financial planning would have to be predicated on the SPCB taking a decision potentially that, they're not going to fund us to fulfil our statutory functions. So it is certainly something that we are looking at and that we are happy to look at. In terms of our stability, I've been given no indication that the SPCB anticipates reducing our funding. Clearly, I went to them just last year to look for an uplift in order to resource implementation of the recommendations, staffing up, clearing our backlog, etc. And that was just granted. So I've had no indication whatsoever that in the next few years, you know, a reduction is possible, although I understand it may be. And certainly, and workforce planning was very helpful in this regard as well. Certainly, if that is something that comes down the line towards us, I am in a position as an office holder to look at all of the functions that I fulfil and to determine what I could potentially be in a position to drop while still fulfilling my statutory functions. You know, I've got a certain amount of leeway in some areas, but not a great deal.
Okay, sorry. So am I getting correct that it's actually you're in a difficult position and therefore cannot produce a medium-term financial plan, or is one trying to be worked up?
I'm clearly trying to work one up. Okay. You know, whenever an auditor makes a recommendation to me, you know, I take that recommendation very, very seriously. But equally, you know, Audit Scotland does say, you know, we are in a position to help you with advice and guidance if you're not entirely clear what's anticipated, and that's the stage we're in at the moment.
So you couldn't give us an indication of how long you think it would take to get one in place?
If we have a clearer indication of what potentially it might look like, it would take no time at all. I don't think, you know, I mean, you know, a matter of weeks. But it genuinely is just we aren't entirely clear what's anticipated, although I think we've got the material already in order for us to put something together that would meet the expectation.
Okay. I think I'd feel comfortable knowing that you got that information so that we could,
yes,
could see that. But that's great. Thank you very much indeed for your answer.
Thank you. Thank you. I just wanted to turn, and we mentioned at the very beginning about the number of recommendations. I think you'd subdivided some of the recommendations, so you're working on 26 recommendations. And based on the Audit Scotland breakdown, it was 22 recommendations, and the report we had was that 10 had been implemented, 10 were work in progress, and 2 had been set aside or had been overtaken by events and so on. I mean, could you tell us what progress you are making? I mean, do you accept that breakdown, that analysis that says some of them have been implemented, you know, around half of them, but around half of them are still work in progress? Is that still a representation that you recognise of where you are as an organisation?
Please believe me when I say that I am not trying to fudge this answer. And again, you know, this is something that I track regularly, and I am happy to provide the committee with a very full and detailed breakdown of how we are doing against each of those recommendations. And I'm happy to provide a summary to you right now if that would be helpful. It's a bit more nuanced than that, and in some cases the targets have moved a little, which, you know, and again, I'm not having a go at the auditors about that. They're providing.
Yes, I don't recommend that.
No, Bruce. Absolutely not, because I am now subject to direct audit by Audit Scotland, which I welcome, but some of them have kind of been moving targets. So I'll give you an example. The recommendation was that we conduct workforce planning. I conducted workforce planning last year, but, you know, that's still live, I think, as far as audit's concerned, because now I'm going through, you know, recruitment and induction.
But, I mean, Ros McCall, yes, touched on that, yes, you know, in her questions. I mean, again, in the report that we have before us from Audit, yes, Scotland, yes, which is a recent report, albeit, yes, on the previous financial year,
yes,
it recounts that there was a proposal to restructure the staffing in the office, and that would generate savings of almost £500,000, £450,000, and then that's been reversed. I mean, which I think sends a signal to us that there was a proposal to scale down quite significantly the operations of the Commissioner's office, maybe in line with this 84% rejection rate. I don't know.
So yes,
but I mean, if you could come back to that point, that would,
yes,
be helpful.
Yes, no, absolutely. You've hit the nail on the head. But so. So we had two recommendations within that initial report. One was we should, you know, review the anticipated savings from a restructuring, which had actually were two restructurings that were carried out under my predecessor, and it had scaled down what was available to the Commissioner in order to fulfil the statutory function. So that was prior to my time in post and it related to, you know, the financial year when my predecessor was still in post. And then over and above that, but you should do workforce planning to establish how much staff you actually need. So, you know, clearly in respect of making savings based on the restructuring, and actually there was another recommendation that I recruit immediately into vacant posts because I was carrying, you know, a good number of vacancies. So there was a bit of a tension between those things. If the audit had identified you don't have sufficient staff basically to fulfil your statutory function, but also could you tell us, you know, how much you've saved because of the reduction in staff? So clearly the first of those, you know, savings from the reductions in staff, and it immediately became redundant because the reductions in staff were inappropriate. I've got no other way of putting it. So workforce planning had to be done, and it was done, but now we're looking at the recruitment exercise. But, you know, that was one recommendation that I feel that we did fulfil our obligations in respect to that. Same with the manual. Yeah, as I said, you know, we've had a manual since 2021. The fact that I chose to publicly consult on it before, you know, like publishing a final version, I see that as something that's been completed some time ago. And this is constant work in progress as well. So, you know, I'm not saying that there's anything inaccurate in the report that's before you, but I've been working really hard alongside a very dedicated team of people for 2 years to implement all of these recommendations and do more than, you know, what was recommended for us. So the progress is constant, absolutely constant. And the picture changes very, very regularly. We have monthly senior management team meetings and I'm pushing new things through each and every one of those monthly meetings. So, you know, we aren't static, and the fact that the picture has changed and continues to change, I would hope should not come as a surprise to the committee. I'm happy to go through the 26 now if you would find that helpful, or send it to the committee after today.
That's a provocative question that you put there, Mr. Brewster. No, we don't want you to go through it. I think what, as a public audit committee, we are interested in, though, is, if you sat here and said we've arrived and everything's been done, you know, we would probably question whether that's probable or not. But I think what we do want to get a sense of is, out of your 26 or the 22 as accounted for by the audit, the auditor said that they thought it was about half and half. Half had been fully implemented, to the credit of you and the people working in the organisation, and a half were, again, quite creditably, I think, work in progress.
Yes.
I think, and we recognise that some of these things are moving targets and there are changes. It's a dynamic organisation. I mean, I think you coined the memorable phrase that it's akin to rebuilding a plane in flight, which is a rather good way of putting it. But where then do you think, you know, you don't need to go through each one individually, but is it about half that are still work in progress, or is it, you know, have more been implemented? Are more recommendations ones that can readily be implemented? And you say, yes, we've done that now and we can move on to something else.
Yes. So of the ones that are categorised as work in progress, and as I say, it's quite nuanced, but let me just pluck one out there. A review of all our policies. So, you know, that was one of the recommendations. So we've got 96 policies and procedures sitting on our register. We are currently sitting with 7 sort of relatively minor and technical ones. So, you know, that's one of the recommendations that's not fully implemented. But, you know, the policies come before the senior management team every month, and then in front of all the staff every month, because, you know, we consult on prospective changes to those. So, yes, it would appear on its surface that, you know, that's not a fully implemented recommendation, but I would suggest, that we've made significant progress in that respect. Review of the website, that was a separate project plan, and again, you know, that's not currently looking like fully implemented, but far and away the majority of the website has now been reviewed, and, you know, we've just got, I would suggest, sort of fairly loose ends in relation to a few of the, you know, the remaining ones.
Okay, that's fine. Look, I'm conscious that we are coming towards the end of our session, but I know the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, has got a series of questions that she wants to put, so I'll finish with Sharon. Sharon.
Good morning, Mr. Bruce. You've mentioned earlier about the Commissioner's Office being granted additional funding, and you've spoken about workforce planning. Could you, you also said that you had three new staff in place when you were answering questions from Rose McCall. Could you tell me a wee bit more about the current progress in recruiting and training to build capacity and how that's helping to address the backlog of cases?
Yes. So, I mean, we have been addressing the backlog anyway, but bringing on board the new staff will see that cleared, and then, you know, we'll be back to business as usual. We haven't, other than the grade two post that I mentioned earlier, which is the investigation support officer, we haven't yet onboarded the additional investigating officers and the hearings and investigations officer that we require to. So once they are in post, we will make significant progress in respect of complaint handling. Sorry?
How many positions is it in total you've still to recruit for?
So on the investigations front, they're recruited, but they all have periods of notice. So as I said, you know, we went out, advertised in December, and, you know, we went through all the interviews, etc., and the practical tests for people during the course of March. So we've recruited to all the investigations posts that we require, but they aren't all actually in post yet because they are with current employers serving their notice periods. We'll have completed, so they will all be in post by the end of May.
And how are you getting on with the backlog?
Sure. Maybe some headline figures would help. So at the start of that, this last financial year, we had roughly 60 cases, so complaints, sitting at the admissibility stage, which was clearly very challenging for us and for complainers as well. So we introduced a number of measures. It was sitting at between 50 and 60. I said I brought forward workforce planning because I was like, you know, we aren't moving the needle on this, and we absolutely have to recognise we needed more resources, but also recognise that we needed to do something about, you know, the number that were sitting there as well. We introduced a triage system. And the way that operates, it's about capturing evidence before potentially it becomes aged. Also identifying complaints that we ought to take out a turn because people potentially are at risk of continuing harm, you know, maybe bullying, harassment complaints of that type. So, identifying those that clearly, you know, we couldn't investigate. So, you know, if someone was complaining about council services, that type of thing, nothing to do with ethical conduct. So identifying those and letting people know as soon as possible, well, actually, we're not going to take this forward for investigation. All of that's been in place since sort of October last year. We're now sitting, so as I said, start of the financial year, 60 at that stage, and we're now sitting at 22. So, you know, there's been a significant reduction in the number that have been sitting admissibility during the course of the year. What that leaves us, though, is with a rump of cases that do require investigation, some of them quite complex, and we're at a record level in terms of investigations and reports to the Standards Commission. We've currently got 30 live investigations underway. That'll give you an idea. Over the course of the last 3 weeks, we've submitted 11 reports to the Standards Commission. We've got 5 hearings in the pipeline. So, yes, you know, the backlog's come down, but in terms of, you know, live investigations, the numbers are going up, and they only will.
Can I ask, how long does it actually take to deal with a complaint? So from somebody making the complaint to informing the person that there's a complaint against them and then to the conclusion, how long on average is that taking?
I think the last time we had a look at that, and we are planning to actually check the averages again quite soon. Initial assessment, I think we were looking at 13 weeks. That was the average the last time we looked. The investigation itself, I think, averaged 37 weeks, and we did some benchmarking with our equivalents in England and Wales. And that actually worked out quite well. But, you know, that was based on the workforce as it was. I do hope to bring, well, I anticipate that I will be bringing those numbers down. And we have just published KPIs in our manual, which is, you know, this is how quickly we say publicly we plan to get through investigations. But, you know, clearly I'm ambitious in that area because I don't like people waiting to hear either complainers or respondents about the outcome of a complaint. I know that can be really stressful.
And I know you said some complaints are obviously more serious than
yes.
others. Is there support in place for people that make complaints or for people that have had a complaint made against them?
No. And that's a matter of concern to me. It is. It's not as though it's not something I haven't raised with the government, and it's, you know, it's been raised with me in other committees. I did meet with officials most recently, and it's not just me, it's me and the Standards Commission for Scotland, because we both feel that there should be support in place, but I don't think either of our organisations feels that it's appropriate for us to provide that support. I'm the investigator at the end of the day, and, you know, clearly I need to be seen to be wholly impartial and separate from the matters that I'm investigating. That's not to say that all the staff aren't trained, you know, basically to be kind and respectful to the people that we deal with, but providing that pastoral support, no. The codes of conduct are brought forward by the Scottish ministers in statute. And we do feel potentially there's a role for the Scottish Government to be thinking about whether support can be provided, particularly in those sorts of cases. And it's not just for complainers, I think potentially for respondents, witnesses. You know, we know from our Rape Crisis Scotland training that, and we do take a trauma-centred approach to cases of that nature. Interviewing people can be a triggering event in relation to, you know, what they may have witnessed. So, you know, I think it has to be wider. For what it's worth, I might as well relay this to the committee now. I've been in touch with the Standards Commission, and I think our intention is to write to whoever ends up with this particular portfolio, now that there's been a change in ministers, just to highlight the issue and see whether or not they wish to do anything about it.
Okay, thank you. And final question. The auditor also reported some progress in producing a performance management framework tracking progress against the business plan. And the Commissioner's Office plans to introduce performance indicators to track complaints handling by 2023. So could you give us the latest position regarding the performance management framework and performance indicators?
I'd mentioned strategic plan, business plan, individual section action plans, individual staff action plans. For me, you know, that is the performance framework, and we track business, or rather progress against our business plan at every senior management team meeting, and every year we publish progress against that last year's business plan. So we'll be doing that shortly. The only missing element was KPIs. As I said, are publishing the manual tomorrow, so that will include all the KPIs in relation to time taken for investigations. We've got a range of statutory KPIs that we're obliged to report against in our annual report. I've introduced some new ones as well, and, you know, I'd mentioned regular SMT meetings. I drafted these last February. And I only managed to get secure SMT agreement to their implementation yesterday. So they'll come in for this next financial year. But in very general terms, we are, complainers and respondents at the end of the process they've been through, they are going to be able to provide me with anonymous feedback on that process and the extent to which the office worked in accordance with our values. And again, we'll be publishing our performance in relation to those matters as well.
Right, thank you.
Thanks very much. Can I just seek verification from you for one point in that last series of answers you gave? Because all of the reports I've seen is that there is an eight-month wait for an initial assessment of a complaint. And did you tell us that has now been cut to 13 weeks, which is just over 3 months?
No, so that's the average, and the eight-month, so you're talking about our banner, is the outlier case. So we are only talking about, so I think it's one complaint from 8 months ago, whereas you know, the others have been cleared. And then after that, I think it's one in August and one in October. Again, we discussed the banner yesterday, and it was our decision to put it up. It was, you know, we clearly don't want to put people off, but we did want to be transparent and manage expectations. We are going to revise it again. I'd mentioned averages, so we're due to, it may already be changed, but we discussed this yesterday. We're revising it again, and we're going to provide a link for people so they can see potentially where they are or where we are in relation to MSP complaints, councillor and member complaints, what the average weight is, and we'll have all that as well. It's probably too much information for a banner, though.
So again, just so I'm clear about it, the eight-month wait figure, you describe that as the outlier, but is that what you put up on your website to inform people who might have a complaint that that is the length of time they may have to wait?
Yes, but we are revising that. So,
and don't you qualify that by saying the average weight is? I mean, I know you don't want to falsely raise people's expectations,
exactly.
But it can also be a deterrence, can't it? If I think I've got a complaint about the way I was treated last week, and I'm told that behaviour is not going to be addressed for 8 months. What other incidents might happen between now and then to other people that might be in the same position as me or what? That seems to be an odd decision, in my view, to take.
Yes, we have revisited it. We revisited it yesterday. So you're not the only individual to make that point. It was made relatively recently at the SPPA committee and also in discussions with the Standards Commission. So we are going to provide a lot more detail so that people have a proper understanding of potentially how long it might be.
Yeah, and I think this also came up at the SPPA committee as well, and you've touched on it this morning, that I think I can safely speak on behalf of the Public Audit Committee to say that we would also be very supportive of support being in place and welfare support being in place for both those people who are respondents, but also particularly those people who have lodged complaints. And I think it seems a little bit unbalanced to have an apparatus in place through which these complaints can be processed without a wraparound support mechanism for people. And I think if you are, and the Standards Commission, if you're making those representations, certainly I think that's something that we would be supportive of.
Thank you.
But look, can I thank you very much indeed this morning for your evidence. It's been very, very useful. You are right, Mr. Bruce. We hope we don't see you next year either, because that will be an indication of how progress is being made. But nonetheless, it's been a very valuable session for us, and I thank you very much indeed for coming in this morning and giving us the answers to some of the questions that we've been putting before you.
I'm grateful for the opportunity. I'll take the time to review the evidence, but it did appear to me that, you know, you would require to see a good bit more detail in relation to some of the responses I gave, so perhaps I'll communicate with the clerks just to ensure that you have everything that you need in order to be reassured about some of what I've said to you earlier.
No, we very much appreciate that, and we very much appreciate your response to Willie Coffey's questions about sharing the legal advice as well. I think that would be that, because that has been a bit of a bugbear of ours and something that we would really appreciate greater transparency on. So again, thank you very much indeed for your evidence this morning. I'm going to suspend the committee at this point to allow for a changeover of witnesses.
Thank you
very much. I'll maybe start in 30 seconds if that's okay. Can I resume the Public Audit Committee's meeting this morning and go to agenda item 3, which is a session where we will take evidence from the Auditor General and his team on the work programme for the next period of time. Can I welcome this morning our witnesses, Stephen Boyle, the Auditor General. Gemma Diamond is joining the Auditor General this morning. Gemma is a director at Audit Scotland, and Mark Taylor is also with the Auditor General this morning. Mark is an audit director at Audit Scotland. As usual, we've got a series of questions which we would like to put to you, Auditor General, but to begin with, also as usual, could I ask you to make a short opening statement to get us underway? Thank you.
Thank you. Many thanks, Convener. Delighted to be with you again to discuss and consult with the committee this morning on my forward work programme. In preparing this latest version, I of course have considered the current context for the delivery of public services in Scotland. Challenges that existed before 2020 have of course, as we've seen, been made worse by the pandemic and the cost of living crisis. Budgets are forecast to tighten further in future years. And there's now an urgent need, therefore, to increase the pace and scale of public sector reform to deliver sustainable public services in future. It remains a volatile time, and my work programme needs to respond quickly to emerging issues, risks and challenges. Public audit will focus on supporting public bodies to tackle the biggest social and environmental challenges that they are facing. This means that my programme needs to be flexible, and I plan to continue to use a range of audit products and approaches to address and report on these matters. My work programme sets out that I am interested in both what and how public services deliver. Turning first to the what, public services face real short-term challenges in both managing demand and budgetary pressures. I will consider how they are managing these challenges and how they are providing sustainable public services. However, this should not be to the detriment of long-term sustainable outcomes, improved outcomes and financial balance. I know that the committee and I share an interest in whether policy ambitions are making a difference to users of public services. This will continue to be a core part of my work. Scotland's public sector, convener, is now at a crossroads. Reform has not yet been delivered on the scale that will ensure public services remain sustainable in the future. We discussed much of this in respect of the NHS at their meeting last week. This is why I'll be focusing on how public bodies are enabling change, both individually and as part of a wider system. That includes how they are embracing key enablers of change, such as empowering people, communities, preventative spend, reducing inequalities, embracing new digital approaches and improving efficiencies. Public audit has a key role to play in supporting improvement and embedding good practice in our public bodies. Equalities has been a consistent priority in my work since I took up post, and it will remain so. I also intend to ensure our public audit reflects the lived experience of members of the public who use and rely upon public services. I will continue to have an interest in climate change, health and social care, public finances and economic growth. I'm also interested in how the public sector is managing its workforce so that it has the skills and capacity to deliver services and deliver the scale of change that is required. Convener, the discussion today, I suspect, is likely to focus largely on my public reporting or performance audit. However, the committee, of course, will be very familiar that each year I will also prepare reports on the financial audit of public bodies. I discharge that responsibility largely through Section 22 reports on public bodies. These will vary in number, largely depending on the issues that auditors identify during the course of their annual audit activity. Through today's discussion and wider feedback from the Parliament, I want to ensure that my longer-term work programme considers the key areas of interest to members of the Scottish Parliament and that it's focusing on the topics that will add greatest value in supporting effective parliamentary scrutiny. And I will use the feedback from your committee and committees across the Parliament to finalise my longer-term priorities and work programme. As ever, Convener Mark, Gemma and I look forward to engaging with you and answering your questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And you mentioned about the committee's priorities, and I'm bound to ask, last week we published a report into the construction of the ferries 801, 802, and in that report there were some recommendations where we thought it would be useful for work to be included in your work programme, recognising that we cannot instruct you to do anything. But those were in areas of the procurement of those vessels and also around what we thought would be a useful forensic analysis of the money that was paid over to FMEL. So my first question that the committee would like to put to you is, have you had any time to consider that, and how do you plan to give that consideration? And secondly, on a broader point, something again which isn't explicitly mentioned, I don't think, in the work programme papers that we've seen, is that whole discussion about the business investment framework that was published last year by the Scottish Government. And I think, you know, we as a committee have got some views about how that might be improved, and I know that you have also, you know, we've had some useful discussions in public evidence sessions with you about that, especially around the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts. So I wonder whether, to begin with, you could just give us some reflections on those points.
Yeah, many thanks, Convener. I'll take those in reverse order. I think you referred to the Scottish Government Section 22 report, or their consolidated accounts rather, as being the vehicle with which we have reported on the progress that the government has made with its investment framework up until now. I've not made any definitive decisions upon that yet about, you know, further audit work. I expect, however, that will remain the case, that through the audit of the Scottish Government and the now annual Section 22 report, that I'll continue to update on matters emerging from the audit, plus following up on themes that have arisen in previous years. The auditor hasn't scoped that report yet. They're really in the throes of approaching the financial year end, but it's very likely that will be the most appropriate vehicle with which to, I think, satisfy our shared interest in that is an effective framework that really the lessons, not just from Ferguson's, but also from other investments, are being understood and the government's approach to managing, I think it is fair to say, higher risk investments that they have undertaken, and that the outcomes from those investments are clear, transparent and deliver value for money. So I suspect that that will remain the best vehicle to do so. Thank you for your reference to the committee's own report on the vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides. I'm very clear on the recommendations that the committee has made to me. I'm also grateful to you, Convener. I guess referencing the, as you considered in your previous session this morning, I suppose the independence of office holders, myself as the Auditor General, not directed by the committee nor by the government, I think just for absolute completeness, we're considering really carefully the very significant recommendations that the committee has made to me in the report. I will of course write back formally to the committee over the next few weeks, set out my intention. There are some life factors that are relevant that will partly inform my work, which is the ongoing investigatory activity that King's Counsel is currently undertaking on behalf of CMEL. So we're tracking carefully the progress with that work, and we're also just taking a bit of time to consider how we might best respond to the recommendation around that forensic analysis that I know the committee has explored and we have discussed on previous evidence sessions. I'll set that out very clearly and publicly in writing to the committee. What I'm saying, I suppose, is that none of the recommendations that you made came as any surprise, to me, convener, and we'll set that out clearly where we intend to go next.
Right, thank you very much. That's very helpful. Can I take us to something which I think you've previously spoken about and informed us of, which is, again, something which I think not just this committee, but the committee in the previous session had identified as being extremely important, which is that we get Section 22 reports, for example, with recommendations in them, and then maybe the following year there isn't a follow-up Section 22 report on that organisation, that public body, and therefore we lose a bit of track about what happens to those recommendations. And so an oversight and having that kind of continuity of interest is something which we would value. And I recall that you'd said that you also, saw that as being important. And I think you were in discussions with the Scottish Government about establishing some kind of framework that would allow that to become a routine part of a kind of routine outcome of the audit work that you do and the reports that you present. From memory, December 2022 was mentioned as a date by which you hope to maybe around the finalisation of that process. So could you perhaps bring us up to date with where things are with that framework and if there are any other steps that you are taking to address what is, I think, by common consent, a deficiency, which is following through and keeping track of recommendations that that you have made and your auditors have made.
Yeah, many thanks, Convener. I'll bring Gemma in a moment, actually, who's been leading much of our work tracking not just recommendations, actually, more widely, the impact that public audit is looking to have through its audit reporting. It applies absolutely to Section 22 reports and the recommendations that we make in those, but also the impact from our wider public reporting, Section 23 reports and other outputs as well. One thing I would say about Section 22 reports before handing to Gemma, who can take the committee through the work that we've been undertaking. I think a fairly well-established process now in place on Section 22s, whereby I have typically prepared a follow-up Section 22 report on one organisation where there has been significant issues from one to the next, that, and indeed, I guess you covered much of that ground this morning in your earlier session. If I don't undertake a follow-up Section 22 report, I will write to you, convener, to the committee, setting out that wider progress. There is also the availability publicly, the annual audit report, which again draws on Section 22 reports, perhaps for a narrower audience, typically for the public body themselves, but available through the Parliamentary Business Bulletin. It says, here is the progress that an individual body has made. Quite narrow, convener, but I think keen for Gemma really to set out for the committee that wider impact and follow-up work that we've been doing. Gemma.
Thanks very much, Stephen. Absolutely, we've been doing a huge amount of work looking at how best to kind of monitor and report on the impact of our recommendations and, our, as Stephen mentioned, our kind of audit work as a whole. What we've been doing is taking forward essentially some pilot work to look at how best do we do that, how best do we gather the information, what resources will it take to look at the implementation of those recommendations, how best do we gather the feedback. Some of our recommendations, as you know, go out to all public bodies, so how best do we gather that information on a kind of a risk-based approach, potentially, so that we've been doing that pilot work to make sure that we can get a framework in place that we know that we can implement and will give us the information that we need. And through that process, we have been talking with the Scottish Government about the arrangements that they have in place for following up on recommendations and how to make sure that the timing of our work and their own work against that work kind of well together within that system, and how that helps to strengthen the system as a whole, essentially, looking around about that. We've been learning a lot of lessons as we've been doing that work. So looking back at some of our recommendations and thinking, well, actually, how can we learn in terms of how best can we phrase our recommendations? Do we sometimes have too many recommendations in our performance audit reports and need to maybe focus down on some key areas of focus? Do we look at kind of putting clearer timeframes on our recommendations? So we've already been implementing some additional guidance internally in terms of, well, how do we write really effective recommendations? How do we put procedures in place so that we agree essentially action plans with public bodies on those recommendations? So give ourselves and the public bodies themselves clarity in terms of, well, actually exactly when we come back to follow up recommendations, what evidence will we be looking for? But importantly, what we want to set out as well is what's the change we want to see for those recommendations, so that we give the public body themselves that accountability in terms of exactly how to implement that recommendation. But we're clear in terms of, well, what's the outcome that we're trying to achieve by making that recommendation. So as I say, our pilot work is largely coming to a conclusion at the moment. We've got a whole lot of information now, and our next step is really to consider in terms of, well, what information would we make available publicly on that? So what information would we report to yourselves as the committee? What information might we put on our website to make for full transparency in terms of people interested in looking at recommendations? But we want to do that in a way that makes it really clear in terms of what's the narrative around about that. So it's not just around about whether or not a recommendation has been implemented or not, but what's that telling us in terms of the change that has happened in those areas, and what does it mean when we bring all that together to look at? Because what we want to do is kind of look at, well, what are some of the themes of recommendations? So is it that some types of recommendations are harder for public bodies to implement than others? What does that mean? And then in terms of our future focus in terms of audit work. So we want to make sure that we're clear around about kind of not just whether single recommendations have been implemented or not, but what does that tell us overall? So we've got a much richer picture of information. So hopefully kind of over the course of the next few months until the end of the summer, we'll be then clear about in terms of that public information that we want to take forward. But a really, really important work, and we're keen to share that with the committee at the right time.
Yeah, thank you. And we've already alluded to the last evidence session we had, where we discovered that 22 recommendations have become 26, not because I think four have been added on, but I think because some of those 22 have been subdivided. Is there interaction with a public body about the formulation of those recommendations quite typically, or are they imposed on that public body?
There absolutely is interaction. So all reports that go to public body, whether it's from Audit Scotland through a Section 22 report or Section 23 report, or indeed from auditors that I appoint, go through a clearance process. So they will receive draft report with the draft recommendations. They get opportunity to agree for factual accuracy, for reasonableness. And then really the evidence of whether it's been accepted or otherwise, convener, is in the management response. So the public body will set out individually on each recommendation what they intend to do, who's responsible for it, and what timescale. The auditor will almost never dictate the timescale. So really, it's for the public body to see within the resources at their disposal how and when they choose to implement that recommendation.
Yes, because it wouldn't be the first time in front of the Public Audit Committee that accountable officers have said that, yes, they agree in full all of the recommendations and then proceed to give evidence that suggests that they don't. Anyway, Ros McCall's got some particular follow-up questions on certain areas, but before I get to Ros, I want to invite Willie Coffey to come in.
Thanks, Convener. And Auditor General, it's really about that whole area of how we can be assured, the public can be assured, that a difference has been made. It's one thing to deliver recommendations and agree with them and say that you're doing them and then you actually do them, but how does anyone determine whether performance improvement has occurred or a difference has been made in the quality and value of the public services? And that's been a recurring issue at the Audit Committee for many years. How do you plan to, if you can, attempt to kind of square that circle, in a sense, to show to the public differences have been made here and here's how we can evidence it?
I think the first thing I would recognise is this is not straightforward territory. You know, I think if it were, we'd have done it collectively ourselves and our predecessors many years ago. Gemma, I want to come back in on this actually, but I think the thing for us is, and we share this, I'm sure, we all want to see better public services. You know, whether that's from public bodies themselves doing so, or as a result of an audit process with recommendations and then associated implementation and impact that goes with that. Sometimes that's quite straightforward. So if an auditor makes a recommendation and that then is implemented and that leads to tangible difference in their performance, that's great. And you can say, well, you can attribute the change in performance to the audit recommendation. More often than not, Mr. Coffey, as you'll know, that there are many other factors that exist that will influence the performance of a public body. And I think I'm keen for Gemma to say a bit more on this. I think that's what we try to recognise through the evaluatory work that we are currently undertaking. Say, well, what are the drivers that will influence the performance of a public body alongside an audit recommendation, the specifics of it, where is audit making a difference? How can we be a bit clearer, more helpful? But that it is multifaceted, I should say. I'm not trying to sit on the fence on this, actually. I think that it's just reflecting just the sheer complexity with which what are the measures and drivers of public body performance. But Gemma can say more.
Yeah, thank you. It absolutely is a complex environment that often we are looking at kind of our audits in areas that have a lot going on. There's a lot of different policy ambitions, a lot of change, and that quite often now that we are reporting on things as they are kind of unfolding, essentially, that our audit doesn't wait for something to finish and then look back. It's often kind of going alongside things, so a number of things happening. What we're keen to do, I think, with our impact work is to look over different time frames to understand kind of impact over time. So we absolutely have the kind of very immediate impact in terms of, well, has the public body recognised our key messages? Have they accepted the recommendations in their report? Is there a kind of positive acknowledgement of the changes required? That then leads into us then following up on those recommendations after a period of time, normally around about 18 months in terms of kind of follow-up of those recommendations and looking at the evidence that is there to support the kind of implementation of those recommendations. But then also to look in terms of what we are very keen to do is that we also look longer term as well. And that's where we're still in development work, but how can we look longer term so that it's not just about individual reports, but kind of quite often what you'll see, and the committee will recognise this, is that common themes come up across our reports. So long-term financial planning has long been a kind of a recommendation that has come through individual audit reports as well as our national performance reports. So how can we look over time to see, actually, can we see a shift overall in terms of long-term financial planning of public bodies, not just in individual recommendation by recommendation? And I think the committee will appreciate as well that quite often the 18 months isn't necessarily long enough to know whether what has happened, the change has made a difference or not. That will unfold in much longer time period. So again, it is very complex, but we're keen to set out as clear as we can in terms of, well, actually, what's the information telling us in the short, medium, and where possible in that longer term, again, so that we can use that information to direct in terms of where our work would add best value, but also where we can think about in terms of additional support for public bodies to be able to implement recommendations in the best way.
Do you ever see the day when your organisation might say, we looked at that organisation then, they've done all these recommendations, it hasn't made a blind bit of a difference in terms of public performance and outputs and outcomes, or spectacular examples of improvements and outcomes, and here's how? Could you see yourself getting into that territory ultimately and saying that as clearly so that the public can get that information from you?
I certainly hope to report on examples of the latter. You know, we'll do it transparently regardless. You know, whether there is more work to be done or whether there is stellar performance. We recognise clearly, I think, kind of to capture some of this in our material today, that our role to support and facilitate improvement in public services doesn't just apply to the body concerned. You know, we expect, to be honest, our work to be used widely across public bodies, whether it's the body themselves, the same sector, or really just across the public sector, that the themes and our recommendations are generally relevant across the piece, whether it's good governance, financial management, sustainability, and other factors. Mr. Cobb, there's one other point I should have mentioned earlier about, is that point about the performance of Scotland's public bodies, how Scotland performs. We have a well-established system in the Scottish public sector through the National Performance Framework, setting out the expectations of how public bodies will deliver. The Public Audit Committee will recall that there's been a number of occasions where Audit Scotland has asked for greater clarity and connection between intended outcomes and public spending. I think having that overarching system, I think, will help provide clarity and moving further to for public bodies to understand how their performance will be, should be shaped, where they fit in, and public audit is part of that framework.
Thanks for that.
Thank you. I mentioned that Ros McCall had some questions in particular areas around you know, the longer term areas of interest that we've got. So I'm going to invite Ros to ask some questions on that.
Thank you very much, Convener. And yes, thank you. Yeah, I homed in entirely on the young children and CALMS and bits and pieces. So if I could ask a few questions on that, if that's OK. And just the way they sort of come up. The draft work programme refers to progress that's been made towards implementing recommendations in earlier reports, such as the 2018 report on children and young people's mental health, the 22 report on city regions and growth deals, and the 21 report on improving outcomes for young people through education. So I was wondering if you could give me a brief update on that and on the progress, if that would be possible.
Yeah, of course. And what we're looking to do is really to signal our interest really throughout our proposals today of where we have tangible plans for further work, and then alongside other areas where we are tracking, monitoring, and will shape further work in years to come. I'll bring colleagues in, actually, and maybe Mark might be best placed to say a bit more about the city deals work in a moment. And Gemma, if you want to comment on any of the others too. Firstly, on educational outcomes, it's, that report, if I remember, convener 2021, I think it was one of the first reports that I brought to the committee, examined really the government's progress in closing the poverty-related attainment gap in Scotland. And our overall judgment was that there was regional variation in Scotland, but that had been limited progress in delivering the government's overall objective. We know and we've seen that there's been significant investment happening already in terms of the Scottish Attainment Challenge funding. We're monitoring that at the moment, Ms McCall, with a view to picking the right time to undertake further work on the ambition to close the attainment gap. It's always a judgment as to when audit goes back in effectively. We don't want to do it too soon, but equally we want, certainly not too late, that you know a policy has been implemented and on to the next thing. So we're tracking that as part of our programme, and it's probably one for in the next iteration of the work programme that we can be more definitive about when we intend to go further. I'll maybe cover just the, before handing to Mark and Gemma, just on the mental health issues. We have work in progress currently on adult mental health services in Scotland, a joint piece of work for myself and the Accounts Commission. That's intended to be published in the autumn, September, where we'll really set out the totality of arrangements, the effectiveness of arrangements to deliver adult mental health service. At the time that the Accounts Commission and I commissioned that work from Audit Scotland, our intent was to review adult services because we had relatively recently looked at children and adult, adolescent mental health services, with the view to, like the educational attainment, follow that up relatively soon. So we're tracking that at the moment, and again, opportunity to be more definitive as we're clearer on progress around the government's policy intent in those areas. Mark may be able to cover city deals, and then Gemma on any other factors.
Thanks, Auditor General. Quickly on city deals, and Gemma may want to add a bit more detail on this. So we are following up the recommendations that were made in the previous city deals report, and that's part of the impact work that Gemma talked about before, and she may want to add a bit more detail on that. But also just to make a broader point about how often we think about these things, and I think it's reflected in the materials before you today, we're often thinking about how does that audit then fit with what's planned and how that comes on. So in that particular area, there's an opportunity, yes, to look back at city deals and the mechanisms that were in and around the way in which those deals were constructed and the wider growth deals out with cities as well, but also to think how might that fit with work that we do around the economy and the future and how we link through and all of that. So that, just to make that broader point, often when we're thinking about the programme, we think about the particular pieces of audit work, but also how do those build up through time and give you exactly the sort of picture that you're asking about in a broad sense here about how things change through time and how they link in through the wider system. But just pass on to Gemma if she wants to add anything to that and the broader points.
Thanks, Mark. Absolutely. Our work in terms of following up on the City Deals report was part of our pilot work for the impact work that I just spoke about. So the team went back and looked at the recommendations, looked at how they've been taken forward, as Mark said, very much in a way to kind of inform the kind of changing landscape that's there at the moment, what lessons could potentially be learned from how those recommendations have been applied, and that context to the context now. And we will be publishing a kind of very short briefing on that in June. What we'll do through our impact work is that we will pull together themes as a whole, as I said, to try and kind of to be transparent and to make that available publicly. But where we think there's kind of helpful information for other public bodies from our impact work, we will make that available publicly. So the City Deals briefing is an example of that. There will also, for our work on education outcomes, will there be a short blog on a very specific point within that where we think, again, there's a public interest and a narrative to tell through that. So the committee will see some of that follow-up work, either in the form of a kind of full Section 23 report where we've got a series of work going on, but also through individual smaller different products to bring those issues to light as well.
Okay. Thank you. Can I just go back to something that you said yourself, Mr. Boyle, regarding moving towards adult mental health? But I noticed that a previous Auditor General made comments to things that were taking place with the Royal Hospital of Children and Young People and Departments of Clinical Neuroscience, and the Child and Adolescent Mental Health Services in the NHS Lothian. So is there anything you can give me an update on that?
So I'm fairly clear that we haven't included those matters in the scope for this report that's due to be published. I don't have an up-to-date position today. I suspect we don't among us. Certainly, we can go back and engage with the auditors of NHS Lothian for an up-to-date position and then come back to the committee in writing.
Okay. And then finally, then I'll bring it back to the slides that were provided. So rather than going off-piste a little bit there, but I noticed from the slides that there's work in the pipeline for early learning and childcare. Can you give the committee some scope of that work at this early stage? And will you be looking at childcare from the view of a child of care experienced, a care experienced context as well?
Yeah, very happy. That audit is in progress, coming towards a conclusion actually on the early learning and childcare. And it's really an ongoing interest that myself and the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland have on the government's progress in delivering the 1140 hours for children and young people nursery provision. The scope, well, I should say, publication for that report is upcoming. We anticipate that will be before the summer recess. We'll, of course, engage with the clerks about when the briefing for that will take place. So we'll set the findings for that report out in detail for the committee very soon. The scope of the report, and the committee will recall that one of the very significant intentions about delivering 1140 and then the expansion of it to, especially to two-year-old children, was to provide parents and carers with more opportunity for economic and building family income and so forth. I think it's fair to say that the government's own evaluation of that aspect of the policy implementation won't yet take place reasonably. That was the intention, but that will come at a later stage. What our report looks to do is to cover, has the policy been rolled out? How has it been applied across Scotland? Are the centres now available? And we'll set that out for the committee. So there is an equalities component to it. Has it covered care experience people specifically? I think the answer is that's wrapped up in a wider consideration. On care experienced young people as a standalone, we referenced that in our previous areas of interest to the committee about potential future work. That remains as a potential for us to consider. We haven't scoped out a piece of work particularly. We are, of course, tracking and monitoring the work of the promise and how that is being taken forward. What we haven't signalled yet is our intent to do any specific audit work. It remains an area we're monitoring closely.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. I'm going to turn to the deputy convener who's got a question to put. Right.
Good morning. When we discussed your strategic priorities and work programme in September 2021, we raised the possibility of using Section 22 reports to highlight good practice across the public sector where appropriate. So we're just wondering whether you've got the scope to do that, if you're hoping to do it, if and when the occasion arises.
Yes, I do have scope to do that, absolutely. And I'll always weigh up the merits of highlighting the performance of a particular public body, either through a Section 22 report or other vehicles. I think some of the work that we're doing around impact is equally a route with which to give profile to where public services are delivering well. And as I mentioned earlier on, Deputy Convener, we absolutely recognise and indeed embrace our responsibilities to promote good practice, and we do that through a range of vehicles, you know, through formal public reporting, through roundtables, through contributions at speaking events, and so forth. Having said all that, I think it is fair to say that the majority of Section 22 reports that this committee considers are in the region of where there's a matter of concern, and I expect that the balance will remain in those areas, that there's that there are weaknesses that need to be addressed. And I should say that Section 22 reports do bring impact, both in terms of the public body concerned, but also the wider sector and hopefully public bodies themselves. So it's weighing up which particular vehicle is most appropriate to discharge my public audit interest in it, and the committee's too. The best example of where I think it's a more balanced opportunity has been the Scottish Government Section 22 report. That is now part of the annual architecture of public audit reporting because of its systemic importance, the scale of public spending that goes through the Scottish Government consolidated accounts, that it's appropriate, in my judgment and that of my predecessors, that an annual Section 22 report is prepared to support public scrutiny and transparency. There are other organisations in that frame too that I'm considering how best to report publicly. And if I may just draw attention to one that's in my submission this morning. Under the Police and Fire Reform Act 2012, the Auditor General has the ability to undertake best value work in police and fire services. Up until now, neither I nor my predecessor considered that was a timely thing to do. Committee will recall it, I think your predecessor committee received many Section 22 reports on the Scottish Police Authority. Those have subsided. Welcome that over the past few years as that organisation has become more stable, delivering its responsibilities. Nonetheless, it still spends billions of pounds of public money each year, delivers a unique public service. So together with the respective inspectors of Constabulary and Fire and Rescue Services, beginning discussions about how and when we might have that opportunity to review how those parts of public services are being delivered. And I would draw that not because I have any expectation that there are material issues of concern there, but rather it's a matter of interest to the public about how public money and those services have been delivered.
Thank you. That actually takes me on to, I'm wanting to ask a couple of questions on policing. So could I just ask, will the work that's planned for policing include a comprehensive review of governance as recommended by the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee in its legacy paper?
I recall this matter well, Deputy Convener, actually, and I think it's perhaps the only area that I have diverged from the interests of the committee in terms of my work programme, where I reached the view that what I understood to be the stability, the round table of interest that was taking place in terms of police governance, that I didn't consider it to be the best time to undertake that work. I should say I did have in my mind that the best value powers at a future date might be an appropriate vehicle to consider policing arrangements, including governance, absolutely in the round. So the quality and effectiveness of governance is central to the consideration of best value. So yes, in the round, a review of governance would be part of that. I wouldn't want to prepare the scope right now in terms of speaking to you, but I think it's safe to say that governance at a high level will be part of that. Whether that extends to the very specifics of which I think may be elements of a legacy of 4 or 5 years ago now about how governance and policing was going through challenges. I don't see that to be the case today.
And last question, are you able to provide an update on the Scottish Government's Scottish Policing Roundtable, which was established to consider the governance of policing in Scotland? You understand that the last minute available online is for the 15th of March 2021 meeting.
I'll do my best to recall where that's reached, actually, but it may be that the government themselves are best placed to advise the committee of their intentions. Having said that, it's my understanding, and I will correct this if I'm wrong, convener, that that roundtable has concluded its work and there are no further meetings intended to be held.
Right, thank you.
Okay, right. Thank you very much indeed. I'm conscious of the time, and I would encourage both questions and answers to be as concise as possible. And I am going to turn to Colin Beattie to ask a couple of questions on digital exclusion.
Thank you, Convener. Attorney General, before I ask that question, I'd like to just briefly refer back to the Convener's remarks at the beginning in connection with the ferries. And as you know, it's that the possibility of an investigation there was something I'd raised on a number of occasions over the past months. And I'm pleased that you're going to be seriously looking at the recommendations and coming back to the committee on that. What I would say, and there's no pressure here, is that I think I would find it extremely difficult to understand if a decision was made not to carry out some sort of scrutiny on this. There's tens of millions of pounds of public money involved in this, taxpayers' money, and I think people have the right to know where that goes. So over to you on that decision, and as I say, no pressure. I don't expect a response on that. It was really just...
If I may, Mr. Beattie, I'm happy to respond. Please be assured, to happen to state for the record, actually, we are considering really very carefully the committee's recommendations, especially on that point, because I know your and the committee's more widely long-standing interest in spending funding that went to Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited and how that money was used. Mark may want to say a word or two about this as well, if he wishes. We're giving that really careful thought about how we might build that into an audit response, but certainly will respond to the committee formally before long.
Just add very briefly, Mr. Beattie, and given that consideration, which absolutely endorse what the Auditor General said about, we're looking very carefully at it at the moment, and part of that is looking at the practicalities around that as well. So we understand at a broad level what the situation is. I would anticipate that we'll do some early work just to see what is the art of the possible in around that, which will help inform the Auditor General's decision.
I understand that the Auditor General, to be fair, has already arranged, and tell me if I'm wrong here, that the paperwork that's sitting at Ferguson's has been secured, although I understand it's not in great shape.
That's correct, Mr. Beattie. So the security of those records has been confirmed. And I don't have an up-to-date position, but I think the last briefing I had was that they weren't collated in a way that was readily accessible into useful information at this stage. That would be part of any subsequent process.
OK, let me move quickly on to a couple of questions I've got. Digital exclusion, very important in my constituency, I may say, because about 5 years ago, Ofcom said to me that 34% of adults in my constituency did not have access to the internet or to smartphones, which is an extraordinarily high level. Hopefully it's improved since then. I've not seen a figure. So it's really important that this is looked at. Now, you state as part of this that you're taking a human rights-based approach to digital exclusion. What does that mean?
Yeah, I'll maybe say a wee bit about the kind of the general intent and turn to Gemma just to say a bit more about the specifics of the scope of the work and the human rights-based nature of that. I mentioned in my introductory remarks about really our long-standing interest in quality, equity of public services. Alongside that, it's not entirely new territory for us either in terms of digital services. It's perhaps maybe 2.5 years now since we published a briefing paper on R100 broadband rollout arrangements in Scotland. What we're looking to do in this audit is really take a view, again, across the breadth of public services, so you know, really kind of using the strength of the Scottish Public Audit Model with myself and the Accounts Commission, how our services have been delivered, how is that changing, what is the intent, how well are people being consulted, communicated with. And there are some, you know, the committee has heard many examples yourselves of, over the course of the pandemic, how quickly public services have changed. We often have heard of, for example, NHS services and near me of GP consultations and other examples alongside that. We're looking to really see if, again, going back to my introductory comments, what does that actually mean for the public? You know, we often hear it from a public body perspective, but how are the public receiving these changes and the services? And again, that kind of perhaps leads into where Gemma might want to, you know, develop my answer is, are their rights being protected in terms of our public bodies recognising that as they change the nature of service delivery, you know, very much embracing some of the positives you'd expect around efficiency and public sector reform, are they still enshrining those, some of the fundamentals about people can access services in a way and that's not exacerbating some of the digital exclusion that you mentioned from your own constituency? Yeah.
Thanks, Stephen. Yeah, this is really part of kind of, I think, what Stephen set out at the start of kind of that interest in equalities and broadening that out into human rights and how best we kind of embed that through our audit approach. And what we recognise is that there's certain topics whereby we can really kind of take a different approach to the audit with that. And by that sense, is for this one, what we really want to do is kind of essentially start our audit with the actual people and go backwards through the service rather than taking the top down, what's the policy, how's that implemented, and go that way. Because we feel that digital exclusion is a really complex area where there's lots of kind of intersectionality of different things happening, which mean that people are excluded from public services. It's not just around about the technology. There's a wide breadth of other issues, including kind of wider poverty-related issues within that. So what we really kind of want to understand is kind of when actually we talk to, hopefully going to involve service users in this audit, that we, when we go from that perspective up through, how does that give us shine a different light on in terms of what public services are doing, how they're coming together with potential other services from third sector organisations to help and best support those people who are digitally excluded. So it's really about us taking quite a different approach to an audit. This isn't new territory for us. We have done a lot of service user engagement before, but this is really about us kind of taking, I suppose, really embedding it within an audit and using that to as our lens through the audit process.
I think there's two aspects to this. The first is, when you're talking about R100, specifically there are those that are excluded because the physical service has not been made available to them and how that impacts on them, their business and so on. But there's also those that choose not to engage, that choose not to be part of the digital world, and there's a surprising number, actually, as I've realised it firsthand. Now, is there a human rights issue there if they take that choice? Probably not. It's their choice. There's those that may not wish to engage because of, it can be age, it can be anything. So how do you separate out where the genuine human rights issue is to target those that are most needful of ensuring that they get digital inclusion?
You're right, both those factors are relevant. I'll bring Mark in a moment to broaden this out as well. I think the important thing is that you know, respecting the choices that individuals will make about how they access service matters. You know, so there, I think we've all seen the way that not just public services, but you know, wider services that the public use have changed. We only need to look at banks in the way that, you know, just the proliferation of branches, how that has changed on high streets across the country, the extent to which those were planned, the public were engaged. It's not a matter for us, but it matters when public bodies make the scale of changes that people are clear that this is happening. Community empowerment legislation is a relevant factor in this as well. What we look to do, and we have a meeting with colleagues tomorrow actually, just to begin to consider the scope of this work, that people's rights are respected, because we can absolutely expect, I think it's fair to say, Mr. Beattie, that the nature of how public services are going to be delivered will change fundamentally over the course of this decade, but that that people's rights and ability to access the service is fair and equitable, regardless of your household income or indeed where you choose to live in Scotland. And that's something we want to evaluate and hopefully make, you know, high quality recommendations on the back of it. I'll stop and bring Mark in.
Thank you, Auditor General. Just very briefly on this point. So the physical stuff, the infrastructure, broadband connections, the availability of devices, of course, it's a big part of this audit work. And as Auditor General says, we're very much at the scoping stage. But what's also clearly in our sights, which relates to the question, is the skills and confidence. And I think confidence is an important word of individuals to be able to use things. So it's one thing having a device in your hand. It's another thing having the skills and that confidence to be able to use that device. And that's very much in our sights as part of this audit work.
I guess... there's always a desire to quantify this, you know, to put a figure against it, put a number against it in terms of exclusion. And I guess what I'm saying is there seems to be lots of different wrinkles in this. And how are you going to tease these out and ensure that when we put that number on something, it's the right thing you're putting the number on?
I think I would maybe just refer back to Gemma's answer, where effectively for this piece of work I think it's really appropriate to start with the public, you know, so that effectively you're describing the nuance between somebody who is digitally excluded either by choice or by the design of others, so we're very clear that we need to capture that as part of the judgments that we make about, you know, how public services are being delivered, what it means for individuals across Scotland. So we're well cited on that, Mr. Beattie, and we'll build that into our scope.
Okay, let me move on to the second question I've got, which is about estates management. As you know, over the years, we've had a look at figures from colleges and NHS in particular, where there's been backlogs of maintenance and where those backlogs, you know, have been categorised from urgent to less so. Now, you're going to be doing work on this. Are you going to be picking out the college sector and NHS for this and providing some sort of a feel as to where we're going? Is it improving? Is it going down? Whatever. Because, you know, there's a lot of money involved in this and we need to understand.
Yeah, I'll absolutely agree. There's a huge amount of public money, both tied up in public assets as well, and money that still needs to be spent to maintain the public sector estate. I'm drawn on last year's resource spending review. When we talk about the components of public sector reform, the Scottish Government set out, and one of them is the intention to review how public sector services are delivered across the vast array of publicly owned buildings, assets that exists in Scotland. It's also been signalled that, you know, that model will change over the course of the decade, very much connected to your earlier question about digital services, that if working habits changed for those people that are employed in the public sector, along with the habits of the public about how services are accessed, we can reasonably assume that the public sector estate that we currently operate, that needs to be maintained properly, won't exist to the scale that it does over the course of the years to come. that transition has to be managed really carefully, you know, so that if we are going to have a smaller footprint of public bodies, that that's done in a way that respects community empowerment, that gives opportunities to communities, and also maximises any return to the public sector where there's been disposal of assets. I agree with you absolutely that historically, and I guess we're seeing, you mentioned colleges, as we talked about last week in the NHS context, that that backlog of maintenance is a result of that temptation to prioritise investment in new buildings and assets without maintaining the estate that exists. We'll look to, we haven't scoped out our work with any great detail yet, but these are the factors that we're actively considering.
You used the term public sector because although I focused on colleges and NHS, which have obviously come before us in big numbers before, there is the wider public sector. Is there anything that would put on your radar that would pull the whole thing together so we could see the whole public sector liability in this regard? I mean, it's probably ambitious, but...
You'll know, Mr. Beattie, that we've been calling for many years now for a whole of Scotland public sector accounts, that as a very helpful starting point, that there was set out what Scotland owns in their respective liabilities. 7 years since there's been a clear commitment to do so, and we don't have one yet. We, through our work and from the committee's own scrutiny, we hope to see progress on that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I think Willie Coffey wanted to come back in with a final question.
Thanks. Thanks again, Convener. Auditor General, it's just a supplementary on the digital exclusion work that you're going to do. I'm really pleased to hear that that's going ahead. I wanted to ask if the scope of that would extend to looking at the models of interaction that can often cause exclusion to widen. And what I mean by that is when people try to get information or participate with, for example, their energy supplier online, it's often a software bot that they talk to, a robot, you know, that they talk to rather than people. And it's very difficult to get to negotiate and find your way through that kind of stuff. So would you be able to spend any time looking at that, these models of engagement that themselves actually widen exclusion, in my opinion?
Yeah, I'm very, very pleased you mentioned that. I'm happy to take that away to our scoping work, which we're in the throes of at the moment. The thing I would recognise is that, you know, we're all different, I suppose, in how we want to interact with public services. You know, for some people, I think I read something recently that said that for many people it's a preference to deal with the chatbot as opposed to picking up the phone or speaking to somebody face-to-face. From a public sector service perspective, is that they are the right cost and efficiency, tailor their services so they avoid the very thing that we're looking to evaluate, that people are digitally excluded against their free will. And really it's that, you know, future-proofing and service that we're looking to take forward. So I'm glad you mentioned that, we'll factor that in.
Good, thank you.
Thank you. And I've got just one final area that we wanted to cover before we finished up today, and that was sponsorship of public bodies, which has been something which has been the subject of some discussion and evidence gathering at this committee, certainly over the last couple of years. And, you know, whether it's the concerns we had about what was happening with the Crofting Commission to, I think, more broadly, an undertaking by the Scottish Government, I think, last spring to have a review, and we took evidence in the autumn of last year. But it seems as though it is still an ongoing concern. And I think at one point you said that it might be an opportunity for a fundamental audit of sponsorship arrangements. So I just wonder if you could tell us, in the context of the work programme discussion, where you are on that, because that does seem to be a recurring theme that we would like to see some progress made on.
Yeah, I share your wish, Convener, that there is progress made on that. And listen carefully to the Permanent Secretary when he gave evidence to the committee a couple of months ago about the progress that they made against the consultants' recommendations. And alongside that, the judgment that I made in the Section 22 that there are still risks for the government to implement the recommendations successfully to lead to more effective sponsorship. The vehicle that, and I haven't been, not definitive on this yet, but I think it's most likely that I'll do that for the time being through the Scottish Government Section 22 report. If progress continues to be made, which I hope it is, we'll take stock at that point to whether it requires a more fundamental evaluation of sponsorship and governance arrangements for the Scottish Government bodies. So I'm just going to take a bit of time over the course of the rest of this year, Convener, just to see the progress that government makes.
Okay, I mean, it's fair to say, and I know some would argue that the Project Neptune outcomes will address this, but there was obviously, we started with the ferries and finished with the ferries. I mean, there was some concern about the sponsorship role of Transport Scotland and how that all fits together. So it's not something which is just a historical thing. There are still some contemporary concerns that I think we've got as a Public Audit Committee about how in practice sponsorship arrangements are working.
Yes, that's true, and I share those concerns, especially given some of the recent examples. I think I'll also look to see the judgments that the Finance and Public Administration Committee make as part of their review of, you know, how government in Scotland is working. I think that will provide very helpful insight that I'll draw on to consider as part of future work.
Yep, I agree with that. So, look, thank you very much indeed for your evidence this morning. I'm sorry we've been a bit short of time, and perhaps we should have allocated a bit more time for this, but it's very important for us because I know that this is a first step in a path that you've got ahead of you, which is to try to engage with other committees of the Parliament to try to inform you on what would be the most useful areas of work for you to concentrate on and to pick up some of their empirical insights over the policy areas that they've been dealing with over the course of the last year and are looking forward to dealing with in the future. So can I thank you, Auditor General Gemma Diamond and Mark Taylor, for giving us evidence this morning, and I'll now move the committee into private session. Thank you.